Welcome to the next lecture in electric circuit analysis. We were taking the basic circuit, and in this particular lecture our focus of discussion will be on charge and current. So let us discuss what is a charge first and how the charge is related to current. Generally, when we talk about a matter which is basically the fundamental building block known as atoms, and each atom basically consists of electron, proton and neutrons. Two types of charge generally are present. One is the positive charge and another is the negative charge. So positive charge is corresponding to the proton, whereas the negative charge is corresponding to the electron. Proton and electron have equal charge magnitude. So both proton and electron will have the charge of equal magnitude, whose value is 1.602 into 10 to the power minus 19, and the unit is coulomb. So positive and negative sign will go for the proton will be positive and the electron will be negative. The presence of equal number of protons and electrons lead an atom to be neutrally charged. So there is no charge for an atom, because the positive charge of proton and the negative charge of electron cancel out each other and the atom become neutrally charged. Electric charge is the most basic fundamental quantity in an electric circuit. So when we are going to discuss the electric circuit, so we should have a clear understanding of electric charge. So electric charge can be due to the charge of an electron or the proton. Now, electric circuit in which only electron flow is relevant. So whenever we are discussing for the electric circuit, we will be dealing only with the flow of the electrons and not the proton. Whereas other devices, so many devices will be there like batteries, diodes and transistors, in which the positive charge motion plays a very important role in understanding the internal operations. But when we talk about the external to the circuit, we typically concentrate on the electrons which flow through the connecting wires. So in the electric circuit, which is due to the connecting wires, we are focusing mainly on the electrons. But when we try to understand the internal dynamics of the flow of the charges, we can take for the positive in many devices like batteries, diodes and the transistors. Now, charge cannot be created nor be destroyed, whether we talk about the electron or the proton, when running in an electric circuit. So when electron is flowing, then the current will flow, but this flow of current in an electric circuit is such a way that it cannot be created nor can be destroyed. This is known as the charge conservation principle. Now, charge in motion represents a current. So whenever you have a charge, which is basically electron in our case, it will be in motion, then it will result in the flow of the current. So we have understood that coulomb is particularly the largest unit of charge. So when we talk about the unit of the charge, we tell that coulomb is the unit of charge. So one coulomb of charge is correspondingly to 6.25 into 10 to the power 18 electrons. So these many number of electrons which we get by dividing one coulomb by the charge on an electron or a proton. So one coulomb of charge will require around 6.24 into 10 to the power 18 electrons to produce the charge of one coulomb. Hence, this is a very, very big number. Thus, realistic or laboratory values of charge are in the order of picocoulomb, nanocoulomb or microcoulomb. We do not deal with the bigger unit of the charge, because this is the large unit of charge which take lot of electrons to produce one coulomb. Hence, we can take picocoulomb, nanocoulomb and microcoulomb as the most realistic value of the charges. Now, a unique feature of electric charge or electricity. So when the flow of electric charge is corresponding to the flow of electricity, the unique feature is the fact that it is mobile. It means that when the charge is in motion, then the electricity flow. So when the charge will be in motion, then there will be flow of electricity. Hence, it can be transferred from one place to another, where it can be converted to another form of energy. So generally, we can convert the electrical energy into many different forms because the charge is mobile in nature. Now let us take an example of a copper wire, an imaginary plane we cut out so that a circular section is taken to understand how the current or the electrons flow in the imaginary plane. So generally what happens is that when the temperature is at room temperature, no external forces can be applied. And we have not applied any external force, and it is at room temperature. So there will exist in the copper wire random motion of the free electrons. So the electrons that are flowing through the copper wire under room temperature without the influence of any external force, the electrons will be randomly flowing in the copper wire. And it is due to the thermal energy that the electron gain from the surrounding medium. So some form of heat energy or thermal energy the electron is gaining, which leads to its flow in the copper wire, but it is in the random motion because no external connection or the pressure has been given. So when atom lose their free electrons, so these free electrons are in continuous motion in an atom. So when the atom is losing its free electron, they acquire a net positive charge and referred to as positive ion. So here we can see in an atomic structure, there will be a positive ion and an electron. So these electrons which lose in an atom leads to the formation of positive ion, and they are in the random motion within the conductor or the atom. The free electrons are able to move within these positive ions and leave the general area of the parent atom. So when the electrons which come out of the atom leads to a positive charge, and positive ions only oscillate in the mean fixed position. So this is the positive ion which will be oscillating in the atom, whereas the electron is loose and it is coming out of the atom. Free electrons find themselves continually gaining or losing energy by virtue of their changing direction and velocity. So electrons which are free in nature is moving continuously with a velocity in a rapidly random direction. So its energy will be either gaining or losing depending upon the external circuit. Some of the factors that are responsible for the random motion of the electrons are: there is a collision with the positive ion and the other electron. So when a positive ion and an electron is colliding with the other electrons, then there is more number of electrons are formed and there will be a random motion. The other factor can be due to the attractive forces of the positive ions. The third factor can be the force of repulsion that exists between electrons. Because the electrons are negatively charged and two electrons are equally charged particle, so there will be a force of repulsion, and that will lead to a random motion of the electron. This random motion of the free electron is such that over a period of time, the number of electrons moving to the right across the circular cross section is exactly equal to the number passing over the left. So we can see from the previous diagram that for a particular cross section, the number of the electrons that is passing to the left of the circuit is equal to the number of electrons which is passing equal to the right of the circuit when there is a continuous flow of the electrons. Now let us understand how these electrons can obey a definite flow of in the definite direction. So let us take an example of a basic electric circuit where we take a battery which is the source of chemical energy. So battery is basically the source of the chemical energy, and it is carrying a positive and the negative terminal. So it will have a positive terminal and a negative terminal. So the copper conductor, so this is the conductor, is connected to the positive and negative terminal of the battery, which is the source of the chemical energy. So the instant the final connection is made, the free electrons, that is the negative charge, will drift towards the positive terminal. So here what will happen is that the electrons will follow a definite path, and from the negative path to the positive path, it will flow to the positive of the battery. Hence, it will left behind the copper wire of positive ions, which will oscillate about its mean position that we have discussed. So the positive ions will oscillate about its mean position, whereas the electron which was flowing in a random direction now is flowing in a continuous direction from the negative of the battery to the positive of the battery. So the direction of the current, that is the conventional direction of the current, will be taken in the reverse direction to the direction of the current flow. Now if we observe the imaginary plane where the current, where the electrons were moving either to the left or the right, now it is moving only in a particular direction and not in the direction which was earlier. So this direction is cancelled out due to the chemical activity, which is the external source. So this is our external source which we have connected. The negative terminal is basically the supply of the electron to be drawn from, and when the electrons of a copper wire drift toward the positive terminal, there will be a flow of the current. The chemical activity of the battery will absorb the electrons at the positive terminal and will remain a steady supply of electrons at the negative terminal. So there will be a steady state flow of the current due to the presence of a battery. The flow of the electrons through the bulb, so when we have a bulb connected in the wire, so this acts as the load. So this acts as the load and this is the source. So we have a source and a load and we have connecting wires. So this is the connecting wire. So any electric circuit requires three basic things. One is the source, one second is the load, and third is the connecting wires. So a complete closed circuit will form, and the electrons will flow through this bulb, which will heat up due to the friction. So friction will result in the heating of the bulb and it will glow red hot and emit the desired light. So it means that the chemical energy stored in the battery is converted to the light energy with the help of the flow of the electrons through the conductor. Now we have, if 6.242 into 10 to the power 18 electrons, these many electrons are drifting at a uniform velocity through the imaginary circular cross section in a particular time, that is 1 second, then we can say that the current flowing due to the charge is 1 ampere. So you will be having a number of electrons as 6.242 into 10 to the power 18, which we have got by dividing 1 coulomb with a value of the charge on the electrons, the charge on the electrons. So this, we are getting this values of the electron, and it is crossing a particular time, that is 1 second, then the current which is flowing through the conductor can be said to be 1 ampere. Hence, the charge associated with one electron otherwise can be obtained as 1 coulomb by the number of electrons. So these are the number of electrons that is passing through a imaginary circular cross section in a particular time. So the charge on the electron will be 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Correspondingly, we can obtain the current equation as, the current is the rate of flow of the charge. So I is equal to Q by T, or otherwise we can write as I is equal to T dq by dt. So the flow of the charge through a imaginary circular cross section in one particular second will give you a current of 1 ampere. So the general relation of the current, charge and time is basically I is equal to q by t, where I is in ampere, q is in coulomb and time is in second. Now from this equation we can form other two quantities, that is the charge and the time. So charge we can obtain as the product of current into time, whereas time can be obtained as the division of the charge per unit of current. The unit of charge will be in coulomb, the unit of current will be in ampere, and the unit of time is in second. So in order to obtain the total charge flowing, we will be integrating it with respect to dt, the total current flowing, for initial value to the final value. Now the current need not to be a constant valued function. So as I thought in the previous discussion, it can be thought to be a constant valued function, but that is not so. There can be several different types of current. That is, the charge can vary with time in several ways. So here we can see that when the current is having a constant magnitude, then this is known as a DC current. Whereas when the current is having a different shape with respect to time, that is continuously varying, then this can be of AC. AC means alternating current. So it can be sinusoidal in nature, it can be exponential in nature, or it can be damped sinusoidal current. So the DC current and AC current are the most important. So the definition of DC current is that a current whose magnitude remains constant with time. And alternating current is the one which varies sinusoidally with the time. So we can see that how the current is varying with respect to time. So that is known as the alternating current. So exponential current and damped current are varying, but when we talk in times of sine function, then we can take to be an alternating current. Now, generally, when there is a movement of the charge, so obviously we expect the current to have an associated direction of flow. Since the charge is moving, that result in the amount of the current, so the current will have certain direction of the flow. Now if we assume a current in a conductor of 5 ampere magnitude, it can have a positive sign or it can have a negative sign depending upon the direction of the flow of the current. So we have discussed that when there is a negative terminal of a battery and the positive terminal of a battery, the electrons are flowing from the negative to the positive end, whereas the conventional direction of the current flow is from the positive to the negative terminal of the battery. So the positive amount of the current is when we take the direction from the positive to the negative, whereas the negative amount of the current will be when the current is flowing from the negative to the positive end. So direction of current flow is conventionally taken as the direction of the positive charge magnitude. So when we talk about the direction of the current flow, it is basically conventional toward the positive charge current movement is there, whereas the current is due to the negative movement of the electrons. Based on this convention, we can say that 5 ampere current may be represented both positively as well as negatively. So in this way, a negative current of minus 5 ampere is flowing in one direction, whereas plus 5 ampere is flowing in the opposite direction. So some safety consideration we have to obtain when we are dealing with the charge particle or the conductor, because the current is very dangerous. So most individuals, it is a general found that they can sustain a current of 10 milliampere for a very short period of time without serious effect. But when the current is exceeding a 10 milliampere, then it causes a certain dangerous situation for the human being. Now, If the current is crossing 50 milliampere, it can cause a severe shock. A current over 100 milliampere can cause to be fatal. So safety considerations should be there in order to handle the current. Moreover, we should not touch a live conductor, as we have understood that it can be very fatal. Also, during the wet condition, when and after bathing, or if we are sweating, then what happens is that the resistance of our body decreases, and it will lead to the flow of the current through our body. So these can cause a severe conditions. So we should not touch a live conductor, and we should not avoid the mixing of electricity with water. So in this discussion, we have completed for the charge and the current. So see you in the next lecture. Thank you for now.